All right, let's get started. Well, welcome to today's symposium. It is my pleasure to introduce today's panel from A-Cube by Airbus Group. As you probably know, well, let me ask you if you know this. What is the largest commercial passenger plane today in production? Very good. They are the maker of double-deck Airbus A380. Now, A-Cubed is affiliated or a outpost of Airbus Group. A-Cube is the Silicon Valley outpost of Airbus Group, a global aerospace company headquartered in France. But that incorporates large commercial aircraft and helicopter manufacturing divisions and a space and defense technology division. At A-Cube, they seek out and develop Silicon Valley products, ideas, and innovations that can disrupt the business of making things that fly. So now let me introduce today's panelists. Are we all here? One, two, let's see, are we all here? Oh, okay, all right, good. Okay, we'll start with Eduardo Dominguez and Perta. COO and Deputy CEO, David Lackner, VP Business Development Senior Leadership, Amelia Marchand, Business Development Manager, Michael Smith, People Operation Manager, Shar Hosnipur, I'm sorry, Procurement Analyst. Please join me and welcome them. How do we do this?
Yeah, we can go. So, good morning, everybody, and thanks for being here. My name is Eduardo Dominguez Puerta. I am the CEO of A-Cube. I've been 15 years in aviation. I joined Airbus in 99. I guess you were not born, or you were just about to be born. Huh? And at the time, we were, I would say, building some aircrafts. We were trying to catch up with Boeing, and along the history and all these years, we have done a lot of things. So for us, it's a great pleasure. Thank you very much to the people here and to the university for inviting us. I have prepared a very quick video of what is a day in Airbus. Huh? I try to avoid the dead by PowerPoint, so you're gonna see no slides, maybe a bit later on A-Cubed. So we're just gonna put on the video. If I can. Yeah. We will need some help here to bring it up. Is it this? F3? Yeah, here we go. Thank you.
Maximum.
Okay. So I hope you enjoyed, and I hope it helps you understand what we do. Airbus was created beginning of the 80s. I don't know if you remember the Concorde. That was the first supersonic commercial aircraft. And that was created on the basis of a collaboration between the British and the French. Then the Spaniards joined, the Germans joined, and I guess you can deduct that from the video. We are a very global company. We employ people from 107 nationalities. We have a global footprint all over the world. We have a final assembly line in China. We have a final assembly line for commercial aircrafts in Mobile, Alabama. We have an engineering center in Wichita. We have an engineering center in Moscow. We have an engineering center in China, in Beijing. We have final assembly lines for helicopters in Dallas. We have final assembly lines for helicopters in France and in Germany. We're doing tons of things and very technical things, and I think they might be of interest to you. Just to give you some numbers about the size of our company, we are 138,000 employees all over the world. Last year, we had a revenue of $67 billion with an EBIT of $2 billion. All that to say that we're a healthy company. We keep on growing. We delivered around 680 commercial airplanes. If you try to make the calculation, that makes nearly two aircrafts per day going out of our doors. We deliver around 400 helicopters. And we also have a launcher division with Ariane 5. And now we're going to work on Ariane 6. So if you like aerospace, if you like space, if you like a vertical lift, if you like to do techie things on a very global and very diverse environment, I think we're a cool company. Unfortunately, we're not very well known in the US. You have the big Boeings, the big Lockheed Martins, and all these guys who traditionally have been very present in the US. But more and more, we think that the US is very strategic for us. First of all, commercially, that's the biggest military market in the world. And we are European leaders in defense, but we don't have much presence in the US. Second thing, and more importantly, at least for me, is because we want to have access to all of you. We want to have access to talent. Europe is cool. People are very smart. It's very diverse. And you have very nice food and all of that. But you have certain things here, for instance, and basically also in the Silicon Valley, that are very interesting to us. So I was 15 years there. I've worked in Spain. I've worked in Germany. I've worked in France. I studied in Germany. I married a French woman. I have French children. You see how diverse. My wife is a stewardess, which means that basically I'm very close to my customer, with everything that means. I was lucky enough after some executive positions in Airbus, working basically on commercial aviation, to come here and set up A-Cubed. And the reason why we set up A-Cubed, and we're going to explain you, Dave will explain you more in detail what A-Cubed is, was because we wanted to be present here. We wanted to escape from ourselves. You haven't had the chance yet to work in big corporations, but you will learn that the big corporations are very slow animals. Decision taking is, it takes ages. There are tons of people that want to have an opinion. There's a lot of politics. And all of that is the antithesis to innovation. Innovation starts small. Innovation goes quick. Innovation accepts failure. And to do real innovation, we decided to create A-Cubed, which is a small place here where we can do all those things. But at the same time, we're backed by the 140,000 people that are doing what you saw on the screen. Which means we have also access to a lot of financial resources, we have access to a lot of technical knowledge, and we have access to a lot of experience. So the whole objective of A-Cubed is to be able to blend you, to blend the Silicon Valley ecosystem, to blend the new technological trends that are coming up with the classical aviation world, so that we're able to define the future of flight. And with that, I'm going to hand over to Dave, who is our Vice President of Business Development and Partnerships, who is going to give you an overview of A-Cubed. So thanks for the interest in our company. Thanks for the invitation here. And I hope to see you, some of you around at some stage. Okay?
Thanks, Eduardo. So I hadn't seen that video before. It looks like a great place to work, really cool stuff. Everything that flies in the air or in space, we have some role in. So let me ask you guys a question. How many of you expect to graduate and end up working for a large company? Pretty good proportion. How many of you expect or hope to work for a startup? It depends. That's a good answer. What about a blending of the two, kind of a hybrid, like what Eduardo described about A-Cubed? Have you thought about that? There's a couple people. I think that's something that's not on a lot of people's radars. It sure wasn't on mine. But the nice thing that I'm going to show you about an A-Cubed is you get the resources of an Airbus and the mentality and speed of a startup. And it's kind of the best of both worlds. And I would argue that's a place where you can accomplish a lot. I want to read you guys a letter that puts a framework around how visionary companies that are doing really well at the top of their game still stay in the mentality of startups. So here's the letter. Jeff, what does day two look like? That's a question I get a lot at our most recent all-hands meeting. I've been reminding people that it's day one for a couple of decades. I work in an Amazon building named Day One, and when I moved buildings, I took the name with me. I spend time thinking about this topic. Day two is stasis, followed by irrelevance, followed by excruciating, painful decline, followed by death. And that is why it is always day one. That's the opening of Jeff Bezos' shareholder letter on the 20th anniversary of Amazon this year. His company hit $900 a share and a tremendous market cap, and it's something we all know and probably love. I'm an Amazon Prime member. And he's still in that mode of, we've got to be acting like it's day one, connecting to our customers, being innovative, and never resting on our laurels. And this is exactly why Airbus set up A-Cubed. And I'll tell you a little bit more about it specifically and what we're trying to do. Yeah, mine's different. Got it. Okay. So once again, my name is David Lackner. I'm the VP of Business Development. I've been with A-Cubed since about December 2015. Leading up to that, I have an aerospace engineering degree from UCLA, a master's from MIT. I worked for NASA for quite a while and took some technology out from NASA to do a couple startups out here in the Valley, and ended up bouncing around between startups and large companies and kind of finding that this hybrid approach is the ideal. So what is the driving force behind creation of A-Cubed? It starts with something that happened in the aerospace industry not too long ago by our friend Elon Musk. And he's doing the same thing in the automotive industry as well. We were very well aware of SpaceX. We were aware of what their hopes were and what Elon had stated he would do. Reusability of first stage of a rocket in order to cut costs by a very significant degree and undercut the existing launch industry. And we laughed at it. We said, you know, that's not possible. And when I say we, I say the entire aerospace industry, not just Airbus. Nobody ULA, none of the existing launch providers believed this was feasible. It wasn't a new idea. It had been attempted before. And this is where the danger comes in, that an industry gets set in its ways. It starts to understand what is possible and what is not possible, and starts to miss the signals, the danger signals of potential disruptive threats. And I would argue that as students coming into your own and graduating and entering into companies, you're going to find that this is not just a corporate thing, but it's an individual thing. And so you're coming in not necessarily knowing what's possible. You are dealing in the art of the impossible, and you should be that voice that says, let's try it, let's do it, let's make it happen. So we recognize that there are significant technological and market and business threats all over, all around, and there was only one way to stay attuned to those and to be able to participate in those, and that's to set up something different. And so our basis for how we operate is that Airbus is not willing or able, because of risk or because of a non-existent market or because it might cannibalize an existing customer market, for Airbus to participate in something. That's where we step in. We identify the white space, the gaps, where technology is being developed at an accelerating pace, where there's a potential for a market, and we develop a plan to break into that that rests within a cubed and this rapid development cycle. So here's where we're a little bit different from maybe some of the incubators that you've heard about in the Valley from other corporate entities. When we develop that white space, we go out and find best of breed people, some of whom are here today, to develop projects. And those projects are pitched to us for a very short, very aggressive, very risky timescale. They are expected to develop something in 2 to 4 years that's going to demonstrate at a convincing scale that something can be done that wasn't done before, or to develop a market that wasn't there before. And at the end of that time, it's a big we'll see. Will Airbus pick it up and create a new business? Will it be folded into an existing Airbus division? We don't know, but that's not the point. We're creating that opportunity space, and we're being ambitious in doing it. So I'm going to run through the projects now very quickly. You're welcome to ask more questions about it or follow the links that we've placed here to learn more. Hopefully you can see those. You can't see them. Okay, we'll make sure that you get them one way or another. So the first, this is a very exciting one to me. This is a project called Vahana. All of this, by the way, is less than 18 months old. We were created about 18 months ago. And Vahana is a vertical takeoff and landing autonomous air vehicle for urban air mobility. So this is basically somewhat akin to summoning an Uber with your phone and having an air vehicle show up. It's going to fly this year. It's in prototype form in an undisclosed location in a warehouse in San Jose, not far from here. So we're actually building hardware, which, as an aerospace engineer, really exciting to see the actual hardware. We're literally bending metal and putting this thing together not far from here. What's exciting about it is it's going to have the type of sense and avoid systems that it will allow it to be 100% autonomous. And since it's vertical takeoff and landing with fully electric motors, it's going to be quiet and efficient. The next project is called Voom. Voom is another piece of this puzzle. It's, again, a platform, but in this case, it's entirely a business model platform where we're pioneering the ability to summon a helicopter in dense urban areas. So maybe the best helicopter market in the world is in Brazil, where it's much quicker and easier and safer to get point to point by helicopter. And so we're doing a beta test there right now of Voom. And again, this is where you pick up your phone, do an Uber-style interaction, and have a helicopter pick you up and deliver you to your location at a reasonable price point. And we'll be rolling that out in several different cities, so stay tuned. Lastly, this is very much in the news right now. is about changing the way air travel happens today. So the airlines have gotten caught up, and they're our customers, so we're very familiar with this and very well versed in it. The airlines have gotten caught up in passenger seat miles. So basically, they're trying to optimize to have the most people crammed into the smallest space to generate maximum revenue. By this next project, we're trying to help them break out of that business model mold. It's called Transpose. Transpose is a series of modular cabins that can be put into the fuselage of an airliner, in this case a cargo freighter, and are slid into the cabin in such a way as to allow themed travel or to change the interior of the aircraft incredibly quickly. So let me see if I can bring up this video for you. This one? Yeah, got it. I think this does a better job than anything I can say. Here's what Transpose does. So I think myself personally and everyone we talk to is pretty excited about the idea of potentially flying on an aircraft that looks like that rather than what we have today. lastly, I just want to leave you with, this is a picture of our office in San Jose on Santa Clara Street. San Jose State and what you're all doing here fits incredibly well into the bigger picture of Silicon Valley and the US and what Eduardo was talking about, us as a multinational global company. I just wanted to point out that, you know, if you look at any number of metrics, Silicon Valley is the top hotspot in the world for innovation. And that's the reason we're here, and that's the reason you're here. The amount of government funding for, as an example, the National Nanotechnology Initiative that goes into developing new technologies domestically and specifically here is astounding by most metrics. And the amount of money that goes into aerospace globally and aerospace in the US in particular is very large numbers. So these are big markets, global entities, large funding, and you are at the center of it all. And we're very happy to be here, and we would love to introduce you to our people and take some questions. So that's going to be our next thing. I'd like to invite everyone to come up. So I think we'll start by, I'm going to stand for a moment. I think what we'll do is we'll start by making introductions with Mikal starting. Sure. Thanks.
Hey, y'all. Happy to be here. Thank you for having us. My name is Mikal Smith, and I am the People Operations Manager, which is a fancy way of saying HR.
Hi, guys. My name is Shar. I'm the procurement analyst at A-Cubed. I make sure we spend our money responsibly.
And you guys, there's another reason you're here, right? Are you not alumni?
Me?
Yeah.
Oh, I am. I did attend San Jose State from 2010 to 2014.
Okay.
But business school, sorry, guys.
Hi, Emilien Marchand. I'm the business development manager. David is my boss, so I'm going to be careful what I say today. Like Eduardo, I'm a European product. I'm not married, but I'm French. I studied in France and the Netherlands and worked in Germany on the Ariane 5 rocket that you guys saw in the video before coming here. And yeah, very happy to be in Silicon Valley right now.
And you know me, I introduce myself. Happy for questions. I don't know who wants to open up.
Yeah, before we, while people are gathering their thoughts, can you guys, maybe one or two of you, tell us what it is that you think is most exciting about working at A-Cubed?
Okay, I'll start. Okay, on top of being in California and Silicon Valley, coming from Airbus in Europe, where as every big company, and when you guys will start working, if you end up in a big company, you'll see that sometimes you can get stuck in a silo and in like just that one task that you do. Whereas at A-Cubed, it's everybody on deck and it's very, you get access. One thing is great that we have such a wide portfolio. And the fact that we are kind of the tip of the sword here at A-Cubed, we see the top management of every other divisions coming to us, wanting to work with us. So that's, for me, coming from Airbus Europe is one of the most exciting things.
I came from a large corporation, and then coming into A-Cubed, it's a great hybrid of a startup environment. And being able to work closely with the CEO, COO every day is a great experience. And I believe our culture there is a big family, and everyone's super friendly and accessible, and they're ready to help you whenever you need them.
So my initial background was HR for technology. So I was with EMC, which is now a subsidiary of Dell, if you're familiar with Dell EMC. From there, went to HR for venture capital. And now being in this environment, I very much appreciate the fact that we are kind of still on the ground floor working our way up. So a lot of questions haven't been answered yet. And being able to decide those answers, build upon those answers, and work with the teams that are answering those questions is meaningful to me versus jumping into a larger machine that's already cranking out. You're getting to be one of the decision makers and a part of a very, you're very influential in the way we move forward as a division or as an organization.
Okay, questions? Come on, guys, somebody's got to start. All right, there we go.
Hi, my name is Trisha. I want to thank everyone for being here today, and thank you for the wonderful presentation. I'm very interested for three reasons. I'm an airline kid. My dad's a pilot. My mom's a stewardess. I worked at Boeing, and I study experience research here at SGSU. So I have a question for Eduardo, and it's that you and your employees have had a history of being at Google's Project Ara, which is the modular phone, correct? Mm-hmm. And with influences of Motorola before that. So I want to know, what have you learned about how people like or don't like modular experiences, whether it's a phone, whether it's an airplane, and like, how do you take that into account with Project Transpose specifically?
Okay, so thanks for the question. And it's always cool to talk to people that know the industry. I think there are several important points here. One of the biggest difficulties of commercial aviation is that we OEMs and aircraft manufacturers, we have no direct access to passengers. Every flight you take, the color of the carpet, the type of seats you have, the type of in-flight entertainment system, all that is defined by the airline. And we architecture our products to satisfy those needs. And we rely on the knowledge of the airlines about the passengers to try to develop our products. Well, as we can see, and that is the reason why we're launching Transpose, that has created an ecosystem that is very static. Our product architecture is very static. The type of business model that the airlines propose to passengers is very static. It hasn't changed during the last 40 years. So I think now what we're understanding is that having direct access to those passenger feedbacks is really important for us to develop the future aircrafts. And somehow we should not just rely on the airline's knowledge, we need also to develop our own knowledge. That is one thing. On the modularity side, we mentioned at the beginning what is the biggest aircraft in the world. It's the A380. I can tell you we learned a lot about the standardization, systems, architecture, because we suffer a lot. And the modular thing and the beauty of Transpose is not just purely the architecture trends that you bring to the product, it's also this commercial side of it. Huh? So what have we learned from ARA? ARA hasn't been launched, and it hasn't been followed up. But what is clear is if you take modularity as a principle, it's applicable to a ton of things. Systems engineering, systems of systems, the way you design and the way you architecture is based on modularity. Software development has been also developed on modularity, how to reuse things. So I'm happy that we're taking those ideas and trying to push them to the maximum and try to see what it comes out in our airplanes. There is an interesting point is that all those structures need some reinforcement. And all those experiences will have less passengers sitting around. So now what we need to find out is if there's a real closing business case to that and if people are willing to pay for something that they were never offered before. Have you ever been offered to get into a restaurant in the air? No. So that is what we need to test. If there is a willingness to pay, and on the technical side, we're learning from the projects to try to export that back to Europe and to embed it in the new philosophy of product architecture.
If I can just pick up on that, the other thing that Transpose gets us is the experience economy is changing everyone's expectations. So when you do Airbnb, you expect a premium experience. The fact that you all have phones in your pockets that can get you any kind of entertainment that you want, anytime you want, on demand, changes your expectations for entertainment in flight. And all of these things are advancing while the passenger experience on board an aircraft, as Eduardo mentioned, has not quite kept up with that, right? So we're trying to create an opportunity for the airlines to catch up with the experiences that you're having in every other aspect of your life, and modularity is a way to do that. And so I think everybody, including the airline executives, when they see this, get quite enthusiastic about it. And then it becomes a matter not of technical, not of even how we do it, but operationally, how do you make it happen? And that's the really hard part. That's a great question. You know, things like what just happened with United, yeah. I mean, no comment, but it underscores the need for a different type of experience.
Thank you. I'm not quite as prepared as the previous question asker. I can't remember who said it exactly, Musk, one of the other big guys, that the difference for the state, the difference between a startup and a big company is the stakes, that if there's a failure with the startup, or with a big company, it's not that big a deal. With a startup, it's the disaster of everyone who's involved. So you guys say you're a combination of the two. Do you agree with that statement? And if so, like, how do you simulate that desperation, I guess?
I'll take a shot at it. That's a very good point, because there's a human nature involved where if you know that you have kind of a safety net, you might act somewhat differently than if you know that if your startup fails, it's just gone. Couple things. The people that join A-Cubed don't necessarily, with some exceptions, don't necessarily have a pathway with an Airbus. So essentially, if an A-Cubed project fails, it's not like they're going back to a cushy job with an Airbus.
They're really treated like a startup. And the other thing is the entire structure of the organization is built around these 2 to 4 year projects. And at the end of that time, you're expected to run with the project and do something with it as if it is a startup. So I think most of our incentives are quite well aligned, and the people are brought in as if they're CEOs. So I think, yes, you do have the best of both worlds because you've got access to incredible resources, but you sure do have that emphasis on you've got to get something done and do it quickly and not let anything get in your way. And there's really no safety net.
Yeah, I just, you know, we think that speed is a way to foster innovation. And we think that the theory of constraints, putting constraints on people, is also a way to develop innovation. So we tend to recall to all the project executives, every week you spend with us is a high percent of the time you're going to be with us. So don't waste your time. Huh? And I think we also try to equip every project on the legal side, on the HR side, you know, like a Formula One team, where you have your racing cars and you try to give them all the enablers so that they can really focus on running. And that is the model that we try to follow.
Hello, thank you for being here. My name is Cindy. I wanted to talk about the helicopter idea. How would those be like? What kind of will it be using fossil fuels, or like what kind of like, you know, how will that run? Like, if you guys are working on that now, right? Yeah. So how will that work? Like, are you guys like looking into like electric helicopters? I don't know. Like, or like, how will it run?
I mean, I don't know if you want to jump.
Are you talking about the Voom or Vahana? Vahana is fully electric, right? So it's just the battery powered. And basically, the range that we're aiming at is about 100 kilometers. And so, which would be, 15 minutes or so? So you do San Francisco to San Jose in 15, 20 minutes, which is pretty cool if you've been stuck in traffic on the 101. So you basically swap batteries between two flights, and then you go on. When it comes to Voom, which is that business model innovation that that we've been doing, that's using existing helicopters. So what we are bringing to those helicopter operators is that right now their fleet is not utilized as much as it could, just because people don't have the ability to just book those helicopters. It's still a very select service, and so we are democratizing that thing. So in the end, it's going to be like booking an Uber. So you'll book a car. Like, we're working with partners with those Uber type or local in Brazil that take you to the helipad, and then you go from helipad, and then a car picks you up and you go to your destination. Those are like regular helicopters, so yeah, fuel, like the current helicopters. And just to pick up on what you said, on your question, the condition for me to work here was to break my European contract, which was basically, if you work in Germany and you have an unlimited contract, you set for life. Like, you don't have anything to do. You can retire easily. But since an expat is rather expensive, I had to break that contract and be hired as a local. So this is an interesting point as well.
The interesting thing for me about all electric aircraft, in this case, Vahana, is it brings a lot of additional benefits beyond just getting away from fossil fuels. So it's quieter, it's cheaper to operate. If something goes wrong with an electric motor, it's not so expensive. You throw it away and replace it with a new one. Whereas the existing engines on a typical helicopter or aircraft are extremely expensive, extremely complicated, require a lot of maintenance. So it's an overused analogy, but it really is kind of like the Tesla of the skies. There's a lot of reasons you want to move over to electric if you can.
So with the Room project, you actually actually fly in the air, right? And like you talk about malfunctioning, what if it malfunctions in the air? Is there any like safety issues with that? And like, you know, you're driving a car, you break down, you can pull it to the side. What do you do in the air?
You said Voom or Vahana?
Voom.
So Vahana is the VTOL electric aircraft. Okay, so we have 8 motors, and if 2 fail, we can still perform nominal mission. So,
yeah, I don't know if you know the numbers for safety in aeronautics, but an A380, the probability for that to have an incident is 10⁻¹. So that is the type of safety requirements that we're looking for. Of course, when you do the first demonstrators and prototypes, you de-scope a lot of those safety requirements because otherwise we would do nothing. Huh? So you need to unleash from those boundary conditions. And then once you have your configuration, once you have tested and you have closed your vehicle, then you need to work on the whole path to safety. Because otherwise you will never be able to commercialize and it's going to remain a toy. And you know, I think if you look at all the products in defense and space in the US and in Europe, you find a lot of toys. Huh? A lot of aircrafts that were built once, twice, they were cool, but they were never economical or they were never practical. So the approach we have here is no constraints, let's build it. However, we have a very big brother looking at us, which is Airbus, with a huge experience. We have more than 9,000 aircrafts in operation. We have more than 7,000 helicopters in operation, so we know what operation means, and we know also how critical for aeronautics is safety. If a Waymo or an autonomous car has a crash like it happened in San Francisco or somewhere else, okay, there's going to be some of a social response to that. If there is something falling from the sky, I can tell you that it's going to probably shut down the development of a sector. So we are very aware, and even more, we are trying to communicate the same type of philosophy to other people that are trying to do the same type of things, because if any of those vehicles fails, that's going to have a knock-on effect on the whole sector. Huh? So we're very much looking at safety.
So we talked a lot about innovation, what A-Cube does, like to innovate the new products, but how do you guys generate revenue right now? You know, you've been running for 18 months. I'm pretty sure Airbus requires you guys to have some sort of money coming in, right, to show that the... No?
So that's, if I may, and that's a very good question. The best way to kill innovation is to put financial constraints around it. So timing constraints... are fine because, you know, if you push people to run, they're going to do things and they're going to take risks and they're going to think in a way that they wouldn't do usually. If you start asking for revenues and if you start asking for profit, at the end of the day, we're going to become very traditional and we're going to look at the economics of things and actually we're going to do nothing. So for the good or the bad, David mentioned that before, we're sitting on $1 trillion backlog. We have a bank in the south of Germany. We spend $2.3 billion on R&D. And actually, we are generating revenue. Voom is generating revenue. But our primary goal during those demonstrations is not the economics of the thing. It's the real demonstration. Having the medium-term look there, present. How can we commercialize those things? But we try to avoid the financial constraints as the main ones. That is the approach.
Hi, Okay, so I really liked your guys' transpose idea with the modules, but how would you approach safety from that? Because I noticed like the sides were like glass, so if like a motor went out on one side and it like flipped, and they're like, I don't know, I didn't see any like seatbelt ideas, so I don't know if like people would all like fall to the glass, you know?
Okay, so I mean, as I said, safety is in our DNA and safety is in our blood. The first thing is that the aircraft that we're proposing to use for transpose is existing. So it's a 330 freighter. You can see some of them used by FedEx and other people. So in terms of product development, the product is existing. So safety-wise, it's already proven. Where we have been a bit, disruptive has been on the cargo loading systems approach, because that is a very heavy system. And we're trying to rethink that. Funnily enough, you are talking about safe belts or safety belts. For me, the windows are more interesting because, of course, there are going to be safety belts. You need to take off, you need to land, there are turbulences, you know, safety requirements, FAA. Of course, there'll be safety belts. But the question is, are people willing to fly without windows? Because a freighter doesn't have windows. Are people willing to test artificial windows, eventually with augmented reality? Are we willing to test different, electric power transmission systems that allow that modularity? Those are the things that we are trying to explore. But that doesn't mean that we're sacrificing the classical requirements due by safety by the Federal Aviation Authorities or the European Aeronautics Safety Authorities. So yes, you will have seat belts. You will be able to have a coffee, but later on you'll be safe.
Hello. As mentioned before, A3 focuses on new innovations, but how do you protect these innovations from your competitors? Do you have to spend a lot of money on patent attorneys?
We do have attorneys, right? you're right. Right, the IP that we generate it's critical that we are able to protect it, and this is also something that our parent company in Europe is very careful about, so that we don't waste the money that we are developing here. And for me, we protect the IP, but what's interesting and very different from what Airbus is doing normally is that you saw the links at the bottom of the slides. We have blogs on a couple of the projects, so Transpose and Vahana. So we are pretty open about what we do, about those innovations and new development, which is not usually the DNA of a big company. So to me, that internally is already disruptive. But we spend a lot of money on lawyers, yeah.
I mean, we are in line with what Emilian was saying. I think we're quite open in using open source. We're quite open in generating collective innovation, but at the same time, we're professional and whatever we consider to be intellectual property or trade secret or something like that is gonna be kept. To your point of competitors, I'm not that interested about what Boeing is doing. You know, history shows that every time you have two big players in a market, there's a new entrant that kills both of them. And that has always been shown by history. So I know what the Seattle guys are doing. I know what their 787, I know their electrification approach, their problems on batteries. That is very interesting. But they are too big to hide. I'm more worried on the startups that are here around, that have tons of money, that with that money can get a lot of talent that is existing and do things very quickly. And of course, there's a big hurdle, and we see that. The president of Airbus North America used to be the administrator of the FAA, which is a nice asset. Because if you want to talk to the government or if you want to talk to the regulators, we know how to do that. A small startup around here, they might have tons of money from Google or from somebody else, but they haven't had the experience to deal with regulators. So I think that is a very interesting point, and we see that there's a lot of happiness around the valley to see us coming in to try to bring some of those people to the same table as FAA, EASA, to be able to drive those discussions. So I think that is a very distinctive value that we bring to the aeronautics and space sector here. Yeah. I'm so happy to see so many questions. You know, I thought you were going to be too hungry. Yeah, or
so one of my questions about the Vahana program was that have you thought about deploying it outside of the United States in certain areas as a form of a test? Because you didn't mention that you want to, that from San Jose to San Francisco, it would take around 15 to 20 minutes. Have you thought about other regions, like, for example, China or India as a potential market?
Of course. The answer is of course. We have carefully mapped the state of regulations in all countries. Regulations are not the same. And the evolution is not going to be the same. So of course we have looked at that. Our main goal here is to demonstrate the feasibility of the vehicle, and then of course there is a path to certification and there is a path to commercialization. We are interested in tackling those markets before with VOOM, so that we're able to understand demand with existing helicopters. And the idea will be that little by little, all these future type of vehicles will substitute the traditional aeronautical industry. We're very present in Bangalore. We have an office in New Delhi. I mean, we are more than present in China. We know the guys very well. But it's true that regulations are pretty much national driven. And sometimes it's not that easy to make them evolve or to have the local lobbying power to try to move that.
Let me ask you the next question. It is obviously that your company is at the cutting edge in many ways, technology, your operation, your culture, your overall thinking. I'm sure you hire many very experienced individuals, highly educated individuals. My question is, your company or a company like yours, do they have a place for a very inexperienced, very young, fresh out of school engineers, like many of our students here tomorrow? I know they don't have a place for a 30 years administrator from a university, but it's more important of where would they play a role, how they will play a role in a very forward-looking, very cutting-edge company like yours.
I think that's a question for me, Cal. And if not, I will add on.
I'm surprised this didn't come up sooner. So I work with a new hire on my team, Tasha, and we also have a talent acquisition team. And at the moment, we are looking towards the summer around how we can accommodate inexperienced or recently graduated talent. We are, I guess, kind of straddling a couple of different worlds as to how they would fit into the organization. But there is an appetite and an interest in, you know, people such as the people in this room, to be a part of A-Cubed and to learn, develop, be a part of what we're building in San Jose and, you know, around the Bay Area. Those questions haven't entirely been answered yet, but I can at least tell you the moment I walk out of this room, I will go back and continue answering those questions to hopefully, you know, give a meaningful answer to this team and to, you know, drum up interest in joining us for some form of, you know, learning and development program.
Actually, I have a question on that. Can I ask a question?
Yeah, you can.
Okay. So for you two, you've worked in American companies before. This is a European company. We have an interesting blend of people, and you know how they say culture eats strategy for breakfast. So, like, what's the culture? How do you like it, or how is it different from what you've done before?
I would say I enjoy it. I am half Persian and half Bolivian, and I speak Spanish, and Eduardo speaks Spanish, and a few of our colleagues do speak Spanish, so it's good to have, like, a good ear to know what's going on and be able to build a relationship, so I feel like I don't feel that left out. Other than that, I feel like everyone's very nice and accommodate you, either if you don't speak, if you're bilingual, trilingual, or whatever. But it's an awesome environment, and I wouldn't trade it for anything.
Yeah, I would, from a cultural standpoint, I would agree. So having, so prior to this group, I've worked for Japanese companies, American companies, EMC, and I think that with this team, we're kind of straddling a lot of different worlds. We're a startup within a larger organization. We're an American subset of a French company. And that, you know, blend contributes to a pretty interesting place. And I think that the way that we communicate, the way we think, the way we work is unlike other groups because of all of those different identities within our team. So echoing Shar, I mean, my family is Black American, Spanish American, Christian, Muslim. I grew up in a Muslim home. And I think that because we're a blended team and a blended community, the experiences that we have within A-Cube are unlike anything else you would probably ever experience in any other company because of all those components that make up a very interesting combination of people.
And even I don't have an aviation background, and they do offer a killer package of pilot school, so that's also a great bonus, which I should take advantage of.
I just wanted to thank everyone. Unfortunately, our time is up. We really enjoyed this. We really appreciate your interest and your questions. I think some of us will be able to hang around for a few minutes. But in general, if you have any questions or interest in following up with us, you know how to find us. Thank you again.